the angels of Jesus said he promised would come in at the end of the age, and they would separate all things that offend and do iniquity. What we're looking here is iniquity. We're looking at iniquity. We're looking at sin. We're looking at jagged, pointed images. No rhyme or reason for a couple of guys with planks or jokesters to go out into a crop field and make something like this. It doesn't make much sense. It has no pattern, no rhythm to it. But knowing how many pieces there are here is where it points. And it's pointy. Everything in it is sharp. And that is the way we treat each other with our tongues. It's called sin. And sin is not allowed in the kingdom of God. God will not allow it into his kingdom. It will have no place there. That means there'll be no violence. There'll be no wars. There'll be no hating. There'll be no ugliness in heaven. It'll be as God desires it to be, and that is people loving one another, people sharing the truth and acknowledging each other and caring about each other. I would want more than anything to have family that cared about each other, and I think God feels the same way. It would be great to have family that truly cared about each other. The situation in the world today is Jesus says that if you love any one family members more than you love him, you're not worthy of him. Sometimes you have to stand back. Sometimes you have to take a strong stand in order to win those that you love to Christ. Strong love, or what they call tough love. And tough love needs to be applied to the church too. There are churches out there that have ministers that have no idea what they're doing. You know, they're going through the patterns, they're going through the motions, they're reading the word, and it's the word that really touches our heart. It's really God's word that touches our heart. The ministers or the men in behind the pulpits are just the voices for the word to come forth. It's the word that moves us. It's the word that touches our hearts. A pastor's life could be totally in sin, and his word will still come forth, and his word will still do the work that it was meant to do. But we're looking at sin here. We're looking at jagged edges. We're looking at iniquity. And to get rid of this, this is what is in our lives. This is what, when I came and gave my life to Christ, this is what was placed on him. This is the ugliness of my sin put upon him. And he replaced it with something much more beautiful. There was a hole, an emptiness. And we try to fill that hole with drugs, with drinking, with sex, with relationships, with hobbies, whatever it is to take our minds off to having to have a relationship with God or to think about God. Nobody wants to think that they're going to have to stand in judgment, but the fact is we will. We all will. There's not one of us who will not face judgment, not one. And so how do we face it so that we know that we're going to be vindicated? How do we be vindicated before a holy and a just God who keeps track of all of our wickedness, who is going to judge us based upon the way we treat others, the way we treat each other? How are we vindicated? We're vindicated when we accept and believe on his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. We accept the gift that he gave us this Christmas. When you accept Christ in your heart, when you say and surrender and invite Jesus to be Lord of your life, well, this ugliness just disappears. It's erased. He gives you a new life. He gives you something and fills this emptiness in you with something more beautiful that you can begin to have an intimate and a more personable contact with God through the Spirit, through the Holy Spirit. Learn to know his word so that you don't sin against them. But if you never hear the word of God, how do you know what he doesn't want or what he will not allow in heaven? His word is important to him from Genesis to Revelation. It's all there, the beginning of man, the end of man. Tells us all of what his plans are and what his purpose is for all of this. And we've come to the end of the age. All the technology is here. All the weapons are here to destroy. The evil will destroy the wicked. That's what the word says. The evil will consume the wicked. The wicked will not enter into heaven. It will not enter in. And so we're looking at wickedness. We're looking at evil and sin. That's what these jagged edges are. Now, you go on the witnesses of two more people. There are people who have seen these lamps, these balls of light in England making these images. This image was not made by men because it just has no rhyme or reason. It makes no sense to you unless you count up the number of jagged edges on, then it'll begin to make sense to you. But these lamps, these balls of light that have been seen in England have been seen by many witnesses, and you can find the first one in the Bible. It shows up in Genesis 15:17 when God's the burning lamp passes through the pieces in the covenant with Abraham. But the seven lamps are the seven lampstands. They're the lamps in which Lucifer carried. Lucifer carried the lamps of God, the light of God throughout the congregation. What he didn't have in the embodiment of God using him as the vessel and vehicle to transfer himself around the congregation to bring praise and worship back to his son, because free will was going south in heaven. And God created this creature to show how much he loves his son and gave him the lamps. But he also had free will. He didn't have to choose the path that he took, but he chose to go that path. He chose to be sin and the leader of it, and to cause pain and suffering. That's what he decided to do. He decided to rebel against God and create pain and suffering. That was his choice. And God decided he would go and show his creation that his way is better than using the free will to rebel against him. He's given all of his creation free will. Those who think, those who have thought, who can speak, have free will to decide to worship or not to worship. And so he replaces this when we receive Christ with something more beautiful. He fills that vacancy, fills that hole, that emptiness within us all that we try to fill with drugs or drinking, with relationships or with hobbies. To fill this hole, you invite Jesus Christ. And that's why Christmas is so important, is what Christmas is about, that God gave us this great gift. He sent us his son to pay the price for this ugliness, the sin, the sharp tongues, the words that we use against each other, the greed, the hate. These things are sin in the eyes of God. And he wants us to be molded and shaped into the image of his son. He welcomes his son into heaven. He welcomes the spirit of his son in heaven. So if you want to get into heaven, it's a good thing to have a relationship with his son. It's like playing with the children on the outside of your house. If your children are playing with kids that you like, you'll invite them inside the house. But if your children are being beaten up, tortured, murdered, killed, and maliciously treated by others, you ain't going to invite those wicked kids into your house. You're just going to tell them, stay out, you don't belong here. But the other alternative where the people go is what Jesus said, a place where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth, not reeling that this creature of his has no creative ability. He can't create anything. He can't make anything. If he could create or make anything, then why do we build his weapons of mass destruction? Why is he using us to do his dirty work? See, spirit uses people, flesh and blood creatures, to accomplish their tasks. One group does the work of God to do good works, and another group just does evil works by ignoring the teachings of Christ, ignoring the teachings of God, and not following the works of God, or what God desires, the will of God. See, the perfect will of God is to serve him and to love his son, Jesus. That's the perfect will of God, to serve him and to love his son, Jesus. I would much rather serve God than be in torment, wanting things the rest of my life that I can't have. You know, only God can provide what I need. Only God is my provider. He provides for me. For now and all eternity, he's my provider. The creature can't provide even a glass of water. Just look at the rich man and Lazarus, the story in the Bible. The rich man wanted Lazarus to dip his hand in water and put it on his tongue. Even after death, the rich man had learned nothing. Still trying to use Lazarus as his servant and as a slave. Well, that's all the devil does, is wants everybody to be his servants and his slaves. And God wants to set people free. We've come to the end of time, to the end of civilization. We've come to the place where all of our technology is here to let everybody know the truth, to tell everybody the story. Let's listen in on Psalm 32. There are 32 points on this jagged thing called sin. this ugliness that Jesus came to die for. Let's look at what Psalm 32 says, and at the end of it, get on your knees, give your life to Christ this Christmas. Jesus is coming back. You don't want to be left behind. You don't want to stay for what this creature, this evil, is bringing you in the new world order. Have a good day. God bless you.
Psalm 32. Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord counts no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. For when I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me, my strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not cover my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. Therefore let everyone who is godly offer prayer to you at a time when you may be found. Surely in the rush of great waters they shall not reach him. You are a hiding place for me. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with shouts of deliverance. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. Be not like a horse or a mule without understanding, which must be curbed with bit and bridle, or it will not stay near you. Many are the sorrows of the wicked, but steadfast love surrounds the one who trusts in the Lord. Be glad in the Lord, and rejoice, O righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart.